तत्सवितृवरे नयम् भर्गो देवस्य धीमहि धियो यो नः प्रचोदयात्। So we are on page number 264 in this English Ramayana, chapter number 15 in this Kanda, the quest for Sita. In swinging legions, the Vanars of the world poured into the cradle land of their race. By the 10th day after Sugriv met Ram at Prasharvan, the hillside reverberated with their exuberance at being all together in the forest of their ancestors, as they had not been for centuries. The trees flashed bright fur, shining eyes, glittering jewelry, vivid scarves, caps, and clothes. Indeed, great, they said to each other, must be the cause that brings all the monkey people on earth together at their king's gate. They were not particular about shelter, and every tree in the forest housed 10 husky males. Sugriv came again to Ram's cave that overlooked the sea of Vanars on the hillside. Bowing to him, the monkey king cried, my people have answered my call. Think that I have 100,000 bodies myself, for it is my spirit that goes abroad as my people to seek out Sita. Ram, the Vanars of the earth and their king are yours to command. Ram said, my loyal friend, let your people find where Ravan lives. Let them discover where Sita is alive. But command your great army yourself, Sugriv. They are your people and you are their king. Sugriv summoned a Vanar chieftain called Vinath. He said to Vinath, take a fourth of our army and go west on the mountains and in their every cave. Search for Sita. Seek her as you might seek your very life if it were lost. Seek her in jungles, across rivers, and upon hills. Cross the Ganga, the Yamuna, and the Saraswati on your quest. Cross the Sindhu. If you still don't find her, cross into alien lands. Scour the frontier countries for her and fly back to me in a month. May success attend your search, for your life shall be forfeit, Vinath, if you do not find Sita. Sugriv sent Hanuman to the south with Angad to lead that expedition. He sent Tara's father Sushen to the east with a teeming force and Shitabali to the north. To each Vanar chieftain, Sugriv described all the lands and nations he would search in astonishing detail. Ram wondered at how widely Sugriv had ranged over the earth and how well he remembered everything he had seen on his journeys. This was not knowledge acquired from stories he had heard. It was the learning of sight and sound, touch, scent, and adventure. Then Sugriv called Hanuman to him alone. Wherever she may be, there is no one more likely to find Sita than you. Not the mortal face of the earth, not the sky with its realms of clouds, not the seven seas can contain you, son of the wind. O ablest of all my people, not even the worlds of spirits are inaccessible to you. You can fly as swiftly as your father of light and air. Do you remember that bundle of her jewels down to us in Rishimukh? The Rakshas took her south that day. While all the others may fail, I know that you, Hanuman, will find Ram's Sita for him. Ram went to Hanuman and put his hands on the loving monkey's shoulders. He smiled at Sugriv's wisest minister. I believe that of all the Vanars, you will find Sita. Ram took a golden signet ring from his finger and pressed it into Hanuman's long hand. Show this to her when you find Sita, and she will know you have come from me. Deep peace came over the spirit of Ram when the Vanar received that ring and prostrated himself before the prince. Ram was strangely certain that when Hanuman headed south to seek Sita, the quest for her would truly begin. Hanuman went down the hill and gathered his Vanars to him. And to Ram he seemed briefly like the moon with a thousand stars twinkling around him. Ram called out again to the Vanar who had from the first impressed him as being the sagest of his kind. Hanuman, he cried, waving, remember, I count on you. Sugriv's army flashed away across the earth on its quest. The monkeys went through the world like fireflies through a jungle. In the south, the Vanar armies went in pageant from Prasharvan, some under the trees, some over the leafy, nimble ways of their branches, and the hillside was emptied of 100,000 monkeys. At the cave mouth, Ram turned to Sugriv and said with a smile, when you described the far countries to your chieftains, I felt you had seen them all with your own eyes. How do you know so much about the earth, Sugriv? Sugriv said, Ram, when my brother Vali pursued me in anger once, I fled through the world. Through forests and across rivers, over mountains and through mazes of caves I flew. With him after me, he chased me across the earth and I fled for my life with my four ministers. Finally, Hanuman reminded me of Matang's curse and we came out of the north to Rishimukh. My eyes saw the world in terror. Fear held them wide open and every detail is engraved on my memory. For years, Vali chased me, Ram, for years I flew before him. Teasingly, Ram asked, isn't it time you returned to your palace? Tara waits for you, Sugriv, and Ruma, and many others. I will see you in a month when the moon is full again. In hope, Ram waited. When he grew dejected, Lakshman was beside him to divert him from his grief. His brother took Ram on long walks through the jungle of endless fascination. Lakshman would always say that sooner than Ram thought, Sita would be found. Vinat in the west, Sushen in the east, Shatbali in the north, combed those quarters for Sita. Great Vanar legions poured through forests and across rivers, over mountains and into deep caves, questioning the wild folk they met along the way, cajoling or threatening them as they saw fit. The monkeys scoured the corners of Bharatvarsha for Ravan's kingdom or lair. But they found no trace of him or of her whom they sought. After the month given them was over, they came back disappointed and apprehensive to Kishikandha and Prasharvan. Sugriv stood on the hill's shoulder with Ram, overlooking his forces that had returned to him empty-handed. He said quietly, "These, I never expected to find Sita. Didn't we see the Rakshas bear her away to the south? Be of firm faith, Ram. Vayu's son Hanuman will return with the news of your wife." The force of Vanars that went south with Hanuman, Angad and Tar at its head, traveled across all the lands that Sugriv had described to them. They were exactly as he said, the intricate caves of the Vindhya Mountains, its thick jungles, the hidden fissures behind many falls that plunge down mountain slopes. They searched all these, but found no sign of Ravan or Sita, nor gleaned any news of them from the denizens of those parts. Forest after forest, they combed, and with each one they passed without finding her, their dejection grew. Once they wandered into the strangest one any of them had ever seen. The trees of that forest had neither leaves nor flowers. Riverbeds they saw here, but no drop of water between their banks. It was a dead forest, where no blade of grass grew, where no living creature drew breath. The silence of the lifeless realm was absolute, and Angad's monkeys were unnerved. Huddling together, the Vanar army crept breathlessly through that wasteland, and at its very heart they saw a rishi sitting in tapasya. His austere face shone, his jata was piled high, and near him was a charming pool on whose bank flowering trees grew, and trees laden with fruit. They did not know it, Neither did the deer disturb the solemn Muni at his tapasya. But he was Kandu. Years ago, his son of 16 summers had been lost in this same forest. When after days of searching frenziedly for him, the Rishi did not find the boy, he cursed the forest and everything in it to be desolate forever. Silently, the Vanars passed through the eerie place. They went farther south. Quite suddenly, they saw trees ahead of them full of lush green leaves. They heard all the sounds of a living jungle, streams full of gushing water and branches full of birds that sang among brilliant flowers and their scents. Fierce tigers, elephant, and deer they saw, and the monkeys heaved a sigh of relief that the bizarre zone of death had ended. But they had hardly entered the living jungle when a Rakshas, whose body faced one way and his head another, attacked them with a roar, gibbering in fright. All the Vanars save Hanuman and Tar scampered into the nearest trees. Not that their perches were safe, because the Rakshas was as tall as any tree that grew there. Angad faced the strange monster alone. In a wink, Vali's son grew as tall as the demon and cried to Hanuman, "It is Ravan, uncle, and I will kill him." Before the Rakshas has recovered from his surprise, Angad smashed his head with a blow. The Rakshas fell, oozing blood and brains. As he died, he told them he was not Ravan, but the Rishi Marichi's son. Would they please release him from the bondage of his fiendish body by burning him? 1,000 monkeys dug a pit for the Rakshas. In no time, they covered him with dry branches and set him alight. They saw a spirit form rise from the fire and, hands folded, ascend into the sky. On the breast, this was a jungle of endless hills, and each one had a honeycomb of caves scooped into its side. Patiently, the Vanars searched every hill and cave, flowing into those mazes in a tide of monkeys, and they came out again, shaking their heads, chattering in frustration. When they had combed that southernmost jungle without success, Angad's Vanars gathered around a great tree that grew in a clearing at the forest's limit. Restless and despondent, wave upon wave of the monkey folk stood around their prince. Angad said to them, "The wise say that unwavering resolve in adversity leads to success. Don't be discouraged. We still have a week left. Let us forget our tiredness and begin again. We may have overlooked the one cave in which the demon holds her." The Vanars cheered him loudly. Like a golden river, they flowed away from the conclave around the solemn tree, shouting encouragement to each other. They climbed the silver hill, Rajat, which was named for its pale color. Cautiously, they peered into every cave on that silvery hill. Each one they entered and searched, and they finally reached the summit, but they found no Sita, nor any clue of her. They returned to Vindhya through the dead forest. Cave by cave, they searched that mountain, wood by wood, but not even here did they find the princess. The last week of the month's grief had given them elapsed. Hunger, thirst, and the weakness of the final week's frantic efforts had taken their toll on the monkeys. The army was exhausted. Great were the numbers and the appetite of that force, and they had denuded the jungles through which they passed of all their fruit. Suddenly, a young Vanar at the foot of the mountain they were combing cried to Angad and Hanuman, "My lords, come and look, a cave we haven't seen before." They scrambled down the slope and saw that there was indeed a cave mouth, overgrown with foliage and flowering creepers and veiled by a strand of trees, as well as if nature had conspired to keep that cavern hidden from the eyes of strangers. As they stood gazing, they felt a gust of air blow at them. The bushes across the mysterious opening were agitated, and the Vanars leaped back in alarm, but only a white stork and some painted teal winged their way out from the cave, squawking at the congregation of monkeys. A delicious fragrance wafted around the Varners invitingly. By now, hunger churned their stomachs as much as failure did their spirits, and they were desperate to discover what lay within the cave mouth. They pulled away creepers, bent bushes, and small trees, and in single file, slowly and often painfully, when some thorny plants scratched their hands and faces, managed to push their way in. That cave was called Rikshpila. But Angad's monkeys did not know this. All was dark inside. When the creepers and bushes outside sprang back into place, no glimmer of light penetrated the blackness within. The monkeys held tightly onto one another's hands, forming a long chain of warners. Now they crept forward. So no one was afraid or lost in that perpetual night. Outside, hearing that an unexplored cave had been discovered, more and more warners arrived at the cave mouth, bending back tree and bush, pulling aside creepers. They also crawled into Rikshpila. For an hour and a yojin, the warners crept along the perfectly dark tunnel. Where the roof was low, they were forced to crawl on all fours. As they went, they were swathed in the ethereal scent, always wafted to them from ahead. Then Angad, who led the way, cried, "Light!" The warners at the head of the chain emerged into another cavern with a high, sloping roof. They gasped when they shaded their eyes against the glare. Before them, they saw a garden bathed in mellow light. A profusion of trees grew here, but they were golden trees. Their blooms shone with colors and stirred the soul. Glistened colors that were not any of the rainbow, nor of this world, but beyond both. From these flowers, the quintessence fragrance that had swept over them seeped all the way to the cave mouth. Clear pools dotted the garden, their water scintillating as if they were made of droplets of diamonds and pearls. An exuberance of water birds swam on these and warbled in joy. But there was more. Imposing mansions of gleaming silver stood among the groves of golden trees. In awe, the warners stole forward. They saw the paths at their feet were of beaten gold, and like the mansions, encrusted with thousands of tiny precious stones. Apart from the birds' songs, a deep silence hung over the garden of enchantment, which was surely a relic from another age of the earth. On soft feet, the wide-eyed monkey folk ventured cautiously into the first palatial edifice. They found it deserted. They came out and went into another, but that too had no living soul within its splendid walls. The warners roamed the wonderful streets for some time, and they saw no one until all at once Hanuman and Angad felt they were being watched. Hanuman glanced at his prince. Angad's eyes roved up and down the eerie street. He said, "Someone is here." The next moment, there was a quaint flash of light and a very tall woman stood before them, an ascetic wearing deer skin. She and they all stood still for a moment, staring at each other. Then she smiled at them and folded her palms. Hanuman answered her, folding his own hands and bowing deeply to her. "Greetings, Swamini. We came through a dark tunnel and we do not know where we are. We were hungry and thirsty, and we saw water birds fly out of a cave mouth on the hillside. We followed their flight and arrived in this wonderful place. What is this garden, and who are you, Holy One?" She raised her fine hand in a blessing. "In olden days, great Maya, the architect of the Asuras who built the fabled Tripura, created this garden. Maya worshipped Brahma with a long tapasya, and the Pitama gave him the magical knowledge of architecture, which once only Ushans possessed. But Maya and Indra had battle between them over a woman, and Indra drove Maya from here with his Vajra. Brahma gave that woman Hema, these gardens and mansions. As for me, I am Swayam Prabha, Meru Swarni's daughter, Meena's friend, and the guardian of this Rikshpila. But we stand talking here and I make you weary travelers no proper welcome. You must eat some fruit from my trees and drink some wine to quench your thirst. Come, good warners. They sat in a grove of trees that breathed quite plainly. Swayam Prabha served them the gleaming fruit, which none of them had ever seen before, which indeed did not grow in the world outside. They were succulent and sweet, but famished though they were, no more than a single fruit each could the warner eat. The tasty flesh restored the monkey's spirits and stilled their hunger completely. The wine Swayam Prabha served them tasted unearthly too. It fetched the color back to their faces and made them light-headed. Swayam Prabha asked, "What brings you to the heart of our forest?" Hanuman said, "We came in search of Sita." He told her their story from the beginning and of Ram's sorrow. When he had finished, he said, "You have been so kind, I am sure fate led us to you. If there is anything the warners can do to repay the debt, you only have to mention it, whatever it may be." But she smiled and shook her head. Hanuman said, "Much as we would love to, we cannot tarry, for our quest calls us urgently. We hoped we might find Sita in this hidden place, but it seems the tide of fortune still runs against us. Shall we return the way we came, or is there any other way back into the world?" Swayam Prabha looked troubled. "Usually no one who enters here may ever leave. If you search for the tunnel through which you came, you will not find it. But I am moved by your mission and I will help you. You must all shut your eyes and not open them until I tell you to. Link your hands and sit perfectly still." The warners obeyed her without feeling anything, never knowing how it happened, and so swiftly they found themselves there in the outside world. Though not in the jungle they had combed for Sita, Swayam Prabha stood before them, tall and serene. She pointed, "Beyond the shoulder of this hill lies the Mahogadi. Fare you well, and perhaps we shall meet again someday along the winding trails of time." And she vanished before their eyes. See, when you read this story, you might think that it's just a made-up story, but this is exactly how Valmiki ji has written in that Hindi Ramayana. Okay, because some of these side stories we are not familiar with. We think that Hanuman just flew from there and reached Lanka. No, all these monkeys, all their heroes, the leaders, they had to do a lot of hard work for a long time. And you can see that searching the forests, cave after cave, forest after forest, how much hard work they did. Okay, so any question? Otherwise, we'll continue with the next chapter, which is called Despair. See, rest of the three parties, they came back. But this party which was gone to south, that was Hanuman, Angad, and a lot of other monkeys too. So Angad and his people had not far to go before they found themselves on a beach. The sea, which many of them had never seen, stretched away to the horizon and roared in their ears. Unknown to them, and by an intuition of her lucid heart, Swayam Prabha had brought them to the western shore of Bharatvarsh. The yogini had called the sea before them Mahodadi. And so it was, vast as they stood forlorn, staring across its interminable majesty. They stood a long time, feeling helpless. The month that Sugriv had given them to find Sita was over. Another week had passed in the world while they ate the Swayam Prabha. Time in her enchanted garden was also unearthly. Winter was almost over and spring would soon arrive in all his gaiety. Angad's monkeys watched the rhythmical waves crash and ebb against pale sands, and they trembled to think of Sugriv's wrath when they returned to Kishkandha without news of Sita. Angad called a council of his chieftains. He said to those leaders of his people, "Every one of you is a warrior and a hero. But who can stand against fate when she is against us? We missed no cave on the hill slopes of the jungles. There is no grove or thicket we did not comb. But we have not found Sita, and we have failed in our mission. Most of all, my friends, I have failed." He drew a deep breath. "A sentence of death awaits us if we go back to Kishkandha. Sugriv will never forgive this failure. He is hard and cruel, our king. I know him. He has no love for me. It wasn't he who made me Yuvraj, but Ram who forced him to. At the first chance he gets, Sugriv will have me killed as he did my father. I would rather stay here by the sea and fast to death than go back to Kishkandha and be murdered by my uncle." The handsome Angad spoke softly, and not in anger, but in sorrow and despair. His warriors' hearts went out to their prince on the windy shore, where gulls wheeled whitely above and the waves washed frothing over their long feet. Some of the monkeys raised their voices to agree with what Angad had said. "You speak wisely. Ram loves his wife so much that Sugriv will have our heads to please him. It would be foolish to return to Kishkandha. What prevents us from searching on for Sita? If we fail, we can think hard of the world to come and starve to death." The Warner chieftain Thar cried, "Why should we despair and kill ourselves for the sake of a man who means nothing to us? Besides, he killed our king Wali. Let us find our way back to enchanted Rikshbila, where our joy was so great that a week passed like an hour. We can live out our lifetimes easily on the fruit of Maya's trees. We need not fear Sugriv there. Why we need not fear Ram or even Indra or Rikshbila?" There were murmurs of approval. Then a silence fell. All the chieftains looked at Angad, asking silently for his opinion of Thar's plan. Hanuman did not like Thar's plan. It was the way of weakness. He said to Angad, "My prince, you are as brave as your father. No, I think you are even braver than Wali was. You will be a great king of our people someday. Yet you have the youthful impetuosity of all the noble and the open-hearted. Because they are afraid to face Sugriv, these warriors agree with what Thar says. But we monkeys are renowned for our fickleness. What will happen when tomorrow the same warriors begin to miss their wives and their children? And let me tell you, not all our common soldiers will like Thar's plan." He paused and scratched his fur ruminatively with a fine finger. "Then some of us are such old servants and friends of Sugriv's that nothing could make us disloyal to him. Let me remind you, we should not make enemies of those who are measurelessly more powerful than we are. We should not act in bad faith toward Ram and Lakshman. Thar may say what he likes, but I, Hanuman, tell you that no cave or garden in the three worlds shall be a sanctuary if we make enemies of Ram and his brother." Swayam Prabha said that Indra's Vajra drove Maya from his garden. Can you imagine then what one of Lakshman's Astar would do to us? When that time comes, Angad, all these monkeys will abandon you. And who could blame them? I say we should go back to Kishkandha like brave warriors and tell Sugriv that though we left no forest or cave unexplored, we could not find Sita. I know Sugriv better than anyone does. His manner is sometimes harsh for what he has suffered, but having suffered as he has, his heart is kind. I don't agree that he made you Yuvraj only to please Ram. Didn't you see how he cried when your father lay dying? He wanted to relinquish the kingdom. Also, Think how much he loves your mother Tara. He will never harm you. Do not let fear cloud your judgment. Sugriv has no son and he loves you like his own child. We must take courage in both hands and go back to Kishkandha. All of us will go with you. We will beg Sugriv to spare your life. But Hanuman had barely finished when Angad cried. Your loyalty to my uncle blinds you, Hanuman. Sugriv is not nearly as noble as you make him out to be. He is neither pure nor kind. He is not straightforward or manly, but selfish. Just think how quickly he has taken his dead brother's widow for his wife, my mother. This is what he always wanted. Years ago, even he sealed the cave where my father fought the Asur. He came home with the lie that Vali was dead. Is such a vanar trustworthy? What about this very quest? Ram secured a kingdom for Sugriv, but once he sat on Kishikandha's throne, did Sugriv remember Ram? You, Hanuman, reminded him of his dharma. And this after the fickle monkey had sworn friendship with Ram before a holy fire. Is such a vanar trustworthy? I tell you. But for the terror, the sound of Lakshman's bowstring struck in Sugriv's heart, we would not be here at all. Whatever you say, I will not trust a coward. Perhaps if we return, Sugriv will spare my life for my mother's sake, since she warms his bed, but he will imprison and torture me. I am not a fool that I will go back to Kishikandha. I will sit here and cast my life away before the sea. If any of you wants to return, he may. If you all want to go, do so with my blessing. Tell the princes of Koshal about me, then my uncle, and at last my mother. I hardly think she will survive this news. As he spoke, tears filled Angad's eyes and trickled down his face. When he had finished, he began to pull up stalks of darab grass that grew behind the sand line to make a bed for himself to die on. Angad's impressionable monkeys were so moved that they too went and touched the sacred waters of the sea with their fingers. They sat around their prince to die beside him themselves. By the hypnotic wash of the waves, the stricken vanars sat and they recalled the events that led to their being out here in these dire straits. They spoke about Ram's childhood, of Kakai's boons, and of Dashrath. These monkeys had roamed in distant lands and they knew all about the blueprints of Ayodhya. Or the exile of Ram, Lakshman and Sita in the Dandak one, they spoke about Panchvati and the massacre of Rakshas of Janasthan. They reminded each other of the golden deer and the abduction of Sita. Then they spoke of Jatayu's death as the scarlet sun sank into the sea, setting the waves alight. They remembered how Ram came to Rishinu and the death of Vali. The wind carried their solemn narration and twilight earth and livid sea heard the tale of Ram. So end of another chapter. So any question? No? So next one is Sampati. On the mountain behind the vanars in a cave swept by ocean winds lived Sampati, the eagle. He was hungry, and when he saw the monkeys on the beach below his roost, he said to himself, fate is kind to me today. I don't have to go in search of my next meal. It has come to my cave mouth. But Sampati was so old and deaf as well that he spoke aloud to himself. The wind which blew at this hour from land to sea carried what he said into Angad's sharp ears. The vanar prince jumped up with a shout. Yam has come as an eagle to take us. Angad was so distraught, he began to babble. All the birds and beasts of the jungle loved Ram. Why? Jatayu gave his life for the Prince of Light. And for Ram's sake, we will also be devoured by death. But Jatayu was fortunate. The Rakshas killed him and he did not have to face Sugriv's wrath. But if you think of why we are about to die, Uncle Hanuman, it is because of Kakai. She is the root of all this misfortune. As he came nearer for his dinner, Sampati heard everything Angad said. In his gravely voice, Sampati called, "Who speaks of Jatayu? Who says Jatayu is dead? It is 1,000 years since I heard my brother's name. Who is the Rakshas that killed him? Who is Ram? I am old and weak, and I can hardly climb down this mountain. Help me, someone. Help me down to the ground and tell me about my brother." At first, the Vanars did not trust the eagle, but Angad went nearer and began the story of Ram again for Sampati's benefit. The ancient bird wept when he heard how Jatayu sacrificed his life for Sita. Angad told Sampati how Ram cremated Jatayu, sent his soul to his ancestors. The monkey prince described how Ram came to Rishyamukh and their own fruitless quest for Sita. At last, he sighed. "Searching for Sita is like seeking the sun at midnight, and we have come to this final shore to die." The eagle, who had wanted to make his meal of them, now said gently, "Jatayu was my little brother. Once I would already have flown to Ravan's city to have revenge, but alas, I am too old and infirm now." His feathers shook, he sobbed like a child, and all the Vanars gathered around the great bird. He saw their eager faces by the dying light. He saw their keen eyes. Sampati, who had lived alone for so long, was moved to tell the monkey folk the story of his own life in his resonant, rambling way. "And I am old. Ah, I am older than you can imagine, my Vanars. Would you believe me if I told you that with these eyes I have seen the Vaman avatar of the Lord Vishnu? When he measured the worlds with 3 strides, Swarg, Bhumi and Patal, and now there is Ram. I was there when the Devas and the Asuras churned the sea of milk to obtain the Amrit from under the waves. I was there when the Halahal was churned up and began to consume the sky. I saw Shiva quaff it and it burned his throat blue. Then they called him Neelkant. I wish I could help Ram, who has come as a man now. But look, my wings are burned stumps and I cannot fly anymore. It was at least 1,000 years ago. Jatayu and I were much younger then. We were in our prime. We competed fiercely at everything. Once we challenged each other to prove who could fly higher and nearest the sun. It was around the time when Indra slew Vritasur. Angling our youthful wings, we flew into the sky like 2 arrows. Up and up we flew for a night and a day, and the sun scorched us. Still we flew on. We were proud then, and each wanted to show he was the stronger one. As we matched each other, wing beat for wing beat, suddenly I saw Jatayu began to fall behind me. Dizziness overcame him, and I turned and clasped him in my wings. In our arrogance, we had flown too near the sun. His body blazed with the wrath of the star. The moment I paused in my flight, the breeze no longer blew around me to cool my feathers. My wings took fire. Still holding the unconscious Jatayu in my arms, I plummeted down to the earth. A long, long time I fell, burning, and I also swooned. I awoke rudely when I crashed on this mountain. My wings were charred, flightless, and there was no sign of Jatayu anymore, anywhere. Again, Sampati's eyes filled as he remembered the vertiginous fall that had changed his life. He said, "Never since have I seen or heard anything of my brother until today. When you, my friends, bring these sad tidings, we wept with grave dignity that aged bird. Angad said, "You say that if you were younger and could fly, you would have attacked Ravan in his city. Do you know where the Rakshas lives?" The great eagle wiped his eyes with his ruined wingtips. He drew himself to his full height, and he was tall indeed. He towered over the Vanars. His eyes flashed a semblance of their piercing fire of old. And Sampati said, I too saw the lovely Sita as Ravan carried her across the sky. She cried out and struggled, but the Rakshas held her helpless. Her ornaments fell from her in a golden shower. And again she cried, Ram, Lakshman, save me. Her garment was a streak of lightning against the ominous cloud that was the demon. Now I remember it must have been Sita. She cried out her husband's sacred name. He paused, their eyes lighting up. The monkey screamed to him. Sampati said, indeed, I know where Ravan lives. I know the place well. Sampati looked around him again in the gathering twilight, and he saw hope flare on monkeys' faces. The eagle continued, Ravan is Vishrav's son and Kuber's brother. He rules the island of Lanka, 100 yojans from this shore. Vishwakarma created wonderful Lanka for the Rakshas. As he spoke, Sampati peered out across the sea and his eyes narrowed in concentration. With his burnt wings, he waved the vanars who blocked his view out of his way. The monkeys also peered where Sampati stood. They saw nothing except smoky waves stretching to the horizon. But Sampati stood very still, his eyes keened, his feathers quivering. Suddenly he cried, I see her in Ravan's garden, surrounded by Rakshasas. I see her crying. Then he grew slack again and looked around at the disbelieving vanars. His eyes shone. I belong to the eldest race of eagles. Garuda is my kinsman. Our kind can see a mouse from the moon if we set our mind to it. For we hunt from the air. Though I am old and my vision is not what it used to be, at 100 yojans, I can still see the lustful eyes on Ravan's 10 heads and the tears in Sita's, soft as lotuses. Sampati's face grew dim again with his own grief and he said, help me to the water's edge. I must offer tarpan to my brother. When he had finished offering solemn tarpan, he came back to the shoreline of dry sand. He glowed with some ineffable joy. Angad, who saw this, cried, O Sampati, a great light is upon your feathers. Can you tell us how we can reach Lanka in the sea? But the eagle shook his head. My part in this adventure is over. This is the evening I have waited for more than 1,000 years. My friends, in the old days, a rishi lived on this mountain. Once I despaired at my flightlessness and my despondence on my son, Suparshu, who has looked after me as if he were the father and I the son. In that despair, I thought, as you did just now, of taking my own life. But even as I stood in this very place and decided to walk into the waves to drown myself, that rishi came up behind me and took my wing. He said, you shall fly again one day, Sampati, be patient. You have a great task ahead of you still. For one day you'll be the eyes that help Vishnu's own avatar find his love. When that day comes and you have shown an extraordinary army the way to Lanka, your wings will sprout alive again. Sampati, be patient until then. So here I am, my vanars, and here you are. And I have shown you the way to Lanka. I feel a great burden lift from my spirit. I feel a light in my heart. Even as he spoke, a golden lambency was upon the eagle's body as he shone like a piece of sun on that dusky shore. As the vanars watched, Sampati's wings sprouted fresh young plumage before their eyes. His stooped back grew erect. His sunken eyes blazed again. He cried his shrill hunting cry in the ecstasy of his transformation, and the beach echoed with it. When the uncanny illumination left his body, it left Sampati young again and his wings whole once more. It is done, he cried, dancing for joy. Vanars, look at me. Nothing is impossible with faith. You will surely find Lanka if only you believe you will. Then launching himself with a few running steps, he spread his splendid new wings and crying out rapturously, flew up into the darkening sky and vanished. Let's stop it here. So any question, comment? See, so much detail, but if you read the
beautiful story,
Urmil Chawla,
even more than that, but this is the essence. Okay,
no,
nothing untrue about what we read.
This we never knew about Jatayu's brother.
You didn't? Oh, okay. Yeah, no, Jatayu's brother, Sampati. Yeah.
Sampati.
And then, about that Swayam, that tall lady, what is her name? Swayam Prabha.
Swayam Prabha.
That story is not written anywhere else, and it's not shown because a lot of details. But you can see that how much time they spent, how much effort these monkeys made to find Sita. And their effort is not done yet. They are still at the seashore figuring it out how to go there. They have found out where Sita is, but now the real ordeal, how to go there, that's going to start.
In Tulsi Ramayana, in Sundar Kand, Hanumanji says to monkeys, okay, please, you are tired, you rest and eat fruits and good things of the forest, and I will be back. Then he goes to Lanka.
Yeah, but first he doesn't know how to go.
Yeah.
Right now, we will read about it because he doesn't know his powers yet.
His powers will be...
It will be reminded to him by Jamvant.
Yeah.
Okay, because he doesn't know, Hanuman doesn't know, nobody really knows how to go there. So it's like we will see that sometimes your own powers, you have the powers, but you don't know.
Yeah.
You're not familiar with it.
Yeah.
Okay, then just like a guru reminds us that you are part of God. Don't forget that. Right? See, guru instills the faith in us. Otherwise, we think, no, we are nothing. We go into desperation or depression sometimes. Right? So, Urmil, you have a question?
I think Pimi has a... Pamela?
Pramila
has a question.
Okay, Pramila.
Ashji, what time span are you talking about? All this...
You remember, they talked about... it was a rainy season.
Mm-hmm.
At that time, Ram and Lakshman, they come into the cave and then waited over there. They gave Sugriv some time. So that must be like a fall time. That now they've been looking, must have a meeting over there, and then they looked around and now they're talking about the springtime. They said the spring has come. So it's for quite some time they were looking. Because it was only the 12th year in the exile when Ravan took Sita. So exile was for 14 years. So it was not just a day or two or a month or two. It was a long time of torture for Ram. And he didn't know what's going to happen. Okay?
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, I think there was a students of spirituality, somebody posted it on it some times ago. The exact number of days Sita was in Lanka and how many days the Vanars and the Ram were in Lanka, how long the war lasted. Just look at that. All the exact dates are written in that. And that is correct. I checked it out. That was correct.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Urmil.
I started to highlight all the similes from here on. Then one day I'll go back and underline what we have already read. Okay. And I want to share those with the girls. It is to be aware only of karma is as dangerous as falling asleep on a brittle branch of a tree. It's like when the God, Lord Krishna also says that always be alert.
Mm-hmm.
Even in Ashtavakra, he says always be alert.
Yes.
He says because not being alert is as dangerous as falling asleep on a brittle branch of a tree.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. We can, if we are not careful, we can slip.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not only for the vanars. For us also, we got to always be, as yoga students, we got to be always very, very careful. We don't want to fall. We don't want to slip.
Yeah. And then later on, he's talking of son of the wind, Hanuman, and who can fly as swiftly as your father of light and air. As swiftly as the as your father of light and air. Rama called out again to the Vanras, who had from the first impressed him as the sagest of his kind. He said, Sugriva's army flashed away across the earth to its quest. The monkeys went through the world like fireflies through the jungle. Again, a good one.
Yeah, there are a lot of good similes.
Nice good similes.
Good similes. And one
I think first, Valmiki ji has done such a splendid job. And then this Mr. Menon, he has done a good job translating it too.
Yeah. So, and let's, the one more.
Okay.
Beyond the shoulders of this hill lies the Mahadwadi. Fare you well, and perhaps we shall meet again someday along the winding trails of time.
Yeah,
because you don't know which way the time is going to take you. It winds its own way.
That's right.
So I love to collect these kind of similes.
Yeah, maybe you can, as you said, you will compile them and then send it to us. Yes.
That's all I do.
Namaste, Harshi. This
Namaste.
Is Padmini.
So Padmini is here. So Padmini will sing, but before Padmini, you sing, we're going to, we have to go through the Hindi part, okay?
Well, I had a quick question about, you know, when Ravana is carrying Sita away, she takes all her jewelry and ornaments off. So as she drops them, I think it's Lord Hanuman is the one who catches all the ornaments and reports it to Rama and tells him that Ravana was carrying her. Is that correct?
Not Hanuman. They were all there together. Sugriv, Hanuman, and some other vanars. There were five of them. They were together over there.
Okay? I saw in that a movie time, once that he catches all the ornaments.
Yeah, no, they were all sitting together. That's what it said in the Ramayana. They were all sitting together over there because they were trying to keep themselves safe from Vali. So it just falls and then they Sugriv keeps them. So later on, Sugriv is the one who brings it back to Ram. Because they kept it. Yeah. So Sugriv is their leader. Right? So Sugriv was... So they kept it and then they showed it and that's how the story started.
Thank you.
Keep a bhajan ready, Padmini. Okay, so let me just go over the title so that you know that how closely this has been translated by Shri Ramchandra ji ka Sugriv ke prati kritagyata prakat karna tatha vibhin vanar yudhpatiyon ka apni senaon ke saath agaman. So all those vanars, they came from all over the country. श्री राम की आज्ञा से सुग्रीव का सीता की खोज के लिए पूर्व दिशा में वानरों को भेजना और वहां के स्थानों का वर्णन करना। सुग्रीव का दक्षिण दिशा के स्थानों का परिचय देते हुए वहां प्रमुख वानर वीरों को भेजना। सुग्रीव का पश्चिम दिशा के स्थानों का परिचय देते हुए सुषेण आदि वानरों को वहां भेजना। एंड सुषेण इज फादर ऑफ तारा। वी रेड दैट। सुग्रीव का उत्तर दिशा के स्थानों का परिचय देता हुआ शतबलि आदि वानरों को वहां भेजना। सो एवरी डायरेक्शन ही सेंट हिज पीपल। श्री राम का हनुमान जी को अंगूठी देकर भेजना। किसी और को अंगूठी नहीं दी, हनुमान को दी। विभिन्न दिशाओं में जाते हुए वानरों का सुग्रीव के समक्ष अपने उत्साह सूचक वचन सुनाना। सुग्रीव का श्री रामचंद्र जी को अपने भूमंडल भ्रमण का वृतांत बताना। Because Ram ji asked, how do you really know all these places so well? He said, I've been hiding, saving myself from Vale for a long time. पूर्व आदि तीन दिशाओं में गए हुए वानरों का निराश होकर लौट आना, दक्षिण दिशा में गए हुए वानरों का सीता की खोज आरंभ करना, अंगद और गंधमादन के आश्वासन देने पर वानरों का पुनः उत्साह पूर्वक अन्वेषण कार्य में प्रवृत्त होना, भूखे प्यासे वानरों का एक गुफा में घुसकर वहां दिव्य वृक्ष, दिव्य सरोवर, दिव्य भवन तथा एक वृद्धा तपस्विनी को देखना और हनुमान जी का उससे उसका परिचय पूछना। हनुमान जी के पूछने पर वृद्धा तापसी का अपना तथा उस दिव्य स्थान का परिचय देकर सब वानरों को भोजन के लिए कहना। तापसी स्वयं प्रभा के पूछने पर वानरों का उसे अपना वृतांत बताना और उसके प्रभाव से गुफा के बाहर निकलकर समुद्र तट पर पहुंचना। So with her power, she just brought everybody at the coast. लौटने की अवधि बीत जाने पर भी कार्य सिद्ध न होने के कारण सुग्रीव के कठोर दंड से डरने वाले अंगद आदि वानरों का उपवास करके प्राण त्याग देने का निश्चय। हनुमान जी का भेद नीति के द्वारा वानरों को अपने पक्ष में करके अंगद को अपने साथ चलने के लिए समझाना। अंगद सहित वानरों का प्रायोपवेशन। प्रायोपवेशन मीन्स अग्नि जलाकर उसमें जाने की कोशिश करना। संपाति से वानरों को भय, उनके मुख से जटायु के वध की बात सुनकर संपाति का दुखी होना और अपने को नीचे उतारने के लिए वानरों से अनुरोध करना। अंगद का संपाति को पर्वत शिखर से नीचे उतारकर उन्हें जटायु के मारे जाने का वृतांत बताना तथा राम सुग्रीव की मित्रता एवं बाली वध का प्रसंग सुनाकर अपने अमर्म उपवास का कारण निवेदन करना। संपाति का अपने पंख जलने की कथा सुनाना, सीता और रावण का पता बताना तथा वानरों की सहायता से समुद्र तट पर जाकर भाई को जलांजलि देना। संपाति का अपने पुत्र सुपार्श के मुख से सुनी हुई सीता और रावण को देखने की घटना का वृतांत बताना। संपाति की आत्मकथा। संपाति का निशाकर मुनि को अपने पंख के जलने का कारण बताना। निशाकर मुनि का संपाति को सांत्वना देते हुए उन्हें भावी श्री रामचंद्र जी के कार्य में सहायता देने के लिए जीवित रहने का आदेश देना। संपाति का पंख युक्त होकर वानरों को उत्साहित करके उड़ जाना और वानरों का वहां से दक्षिण दिशा की ओर प्रस्थान करना। So we read it up to this level. So let's put a little halt there. And Padmini, please sing a bhajan for us.
Namaste. So nice to see all of you. Thank you. Bolo Ram, Jai Jai Ram, Bolo Ram. Bolo Ram, Jai Jai Ram, Bolo Ram. बोलो राम जय जय राम बोलो राम। जन्म सफल होगा रे बंधे मन में राम बसा ले, मन में राम बसा ले। बोलो राम जय जय राम बोलो राम। हे राम नाम पे मोती को सांसों की बाल बना ले, मन में राम बसा ले। बोलो राम जय जय राम बोलो राम। बोलो राम जय जय राम बोलो राम। बोलो राम जय जय राम बोलो राम। राम पतित पावन करुणा कर और सदा सुख दाता। बोलो राम जय जय राम बोलो राम। हे राम पतित पावन करुणाकर और सदा सुखदाता सरस सुहावन अति मन पावन राम से प्रीत लगा ले मन में राम बसा ले बोलो राम जय जय राम बोलो राम मोह माया है झूठा बंधन त्याग उसे तू प्राणी बोलो राम जय जय राम बोलो राम हे मोह माया है झूठा बंधन त्याग उसे तू प्राणी राम नाम की ज्योत जलाकर अपना भाग जगा ले मन में राम बसा ले बोलो राम जय जय राम बोलो राम राम भजन में डूब के अपनी निर्मल कर ले काया बोलो राम जय जय राम बोलो राम हे राम भजन में डूब के अपनी निर्मल कर ले काया राम नाम से प्रीत लगा कर जीवन पार लगा ले मन में राम बसा ले बोलो राम जय जय राम बोलो राम जन्म सफल होगा रे बंदे मन में राम बसा ले मन में राम बसा ले बोलो राम जय जय राम बोलो राम 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 थैंक यू
वेरी मच पद्मिनी ब्यूटीफुल